So next is users and permission. I'm sure you already know this. So who am I shows who is the user logged in at present. W shows how many users are logged in. And not here. So this is my remote machine, which shows who else is logged in here. And my next is ch mode, changing the mode of a file. So ls-l1.txt shows different modes here. So the first hyphen is for whether it's a file or directory. So if it's a file, it won't show anything. If it's a directory, it will show D. So for example, ls-l/dev. So it shows D in front of all the directories, and it shows hyphen in front of files. So the next triplet is for the user, next one is for group, and the last one is for others. The user has read-write permission. Suppose if I want to change that permission, I can simply minus R, it will work. So there are multiple ways to remove a permission. So I want to remove read permission from 1.txt. Now if I do 1.txt, it doesn't have read permission. What I did, I actually removed read permission for both user and group, which I didn't want it. So suppose I want to remove read permission only for user. Is it like this? So let me bring it back to original state. So chmode plus r 1.txt. So now we have 1.txt in original form. U minus R. So let us bring it first in the original state. I think yes, you are correct. 1.txt U minus R. So remove read permission from user, not from others. So if you use simple R, it will remove read permission from all of them. Similarly for group, you can do G minus R. For others, you can do O minus R. For others, if you want to give read permission, you just do O plus R. So ls-l1.txt. So others earlier didn't have any permission, now they have read permission. So this way you can change user modes. Similarly, there is another command chown. It says about ownership. So who owns this file? Srikant owns this file, and Srikant group owns this file. It's also in the Srikant group. So suppose if I want to make, suppose I want, I'm leaving this company or leaving this directory, and I want to migrate all my files to some other user. That case, so I will use chown command. To, I know there is another user. Let me know /home. There is a user. I don't have password for. Okay, anyway. So I know there is a user Amit. Okay, so chown. one.txt amit.amit to 1.txt. This means change the user Srikant from Amit and group Srikant from Amit. For this, it requires a sudo privileges. I think Amit is not actual user in my machine. Maybe I have to use some other user, maybe Manish. Okay. So 1.txt. So now the user is Manish. The group is still Srikant. So I haven't changed the group. You can change the group if I give like this. This will change group as well. So there are other flags through which you can only change the group, you can only change the user. There are different flags with chmod. So in networking, we already seen ifconfig. Ping, you already know, it pings to the network. SSH, we have seen. SCP and wget. SCP is similar to SSH. You can copy files from your machine to a remote machine. Similarly, you can copy files from remote machine to your own machine. So let me copy this 1.txt to the other machine, Srikanth, this machine, and where I want to copy, I want to copy in /temp directory. Okay, so I'm using SCP file name, my user, the user with my remote machine, at the rate, which IP, 10.101.11.109. Okay, this is my lab machine, it's running, we already know we are in same machine. So I copied. So how to validate? So in this machine, remote machine, ls temp 1.txt, so it's there. Similarly, if I want to copy from remote machines to this machine, all you need to do is you have to change the order, copy. So let me find out some file in this temp which I want to copy to my home directory. So there is success_examples_v2.txt. So I know there is a file success_examples_v2.txt. Okay, where I want to copy? I want to copy into present working directory. Okay, just reverse of the previous one. So here is the source. My source is a remote machine, Srikanth at this colon, path of the file in the remote machine, and this is my destination path. So let me put it in my temp directory itself. This ask password of my remote machine, not this machine. So maybe so let me copy this to temp just to reuse my previous command. Correct. So now I copied from my remote machine to this machine. How we can find out? ls-lrt, it will show the latest file. We copied to temp, sorry. ls-lrt, success_examples_v2.txt. Okay, so this is how we copy from remote machines. So file is a command which will tell you what kind of file it is, whether it's a text file, binary file, so user bin ls. So it's an executable file. So this is a compressed data file. File 1.txt, ASCII text file. So with file command, you can know the nature of the file without opening it. DF and DU we already seen. DF we haven't seen. So DF shows the disk partitions. So I have these many partitions. Okay, H means human readable format. Mount shows all the devices connected to this machine. This is not very important. Suppose you have connected, you have mounted multiple file systems to your machine, Windows drive, Linux drive, pen drives, CD drives. So this will list all of them. Tar and zip, okay, free will show the amount of free space in your memory. Okay, so in my case, I have 4 GB of RAM, out of which I have, so let me format it properly. So I have used 3 GB of RAM, out of which 1600 is swap. Sorry, 1600 is actual users and swap is 2. But there is another graphical way to view this is htop. So here you can validate. So out of my 4 GB of memory, I am using 1700 of RAM. And out of 6 GB of my swap space is like your virtual memory in Windows, I'm using only 200 MB. Okay, so free is a command which will show you how much is actually used. So 1600 is actually used and 200 is actually swap space. So next command is tar and zip. So this I find very useful. So for example, I have these 100 files. So if I want to upload these 100 files to my Google Drive, it will take a lot of time. Suppose I want to attach this 100 file. What you will do exactly, you will go to the set directory, you will right click, create zip, that's it, right? But there are convenient way to do this. Suppose you have an application where you have hundreds of directories and you want to make 100 such zip files. One zip file for all directories, you want to make individual zip files for individual directories. You cannot go to each directory and right click and do compress to zip, compress to zip, compress to zip. You can easily write a script, shell script to do that. How? For example, what I will do is I will use for loop. It contains 100 text files. So I want to create 100 tar files. So tar is a Linux favorite compression program. Unlike zip, it is free. It can be used for any purpose. So for each in, let's say, ls-1, do echo dollar each, done. So this way I am telling you how to use for also. This is a one liner. So what I can do, I can copy this same into a shell script. So suppose I will say script.sh, and here I will say for each in dollar, is it visible? For each in $ls-1 *.txt do echo $each done. Okay. How do I execute? Bash script.sh. I just did echo in this command, right? Nothing else. Instead of bash, you can also run this command using /. For that, you have to change the mode, chmod +x for the user. Now I can simply run this as a script. Okay, let me open my script.sh again. So this 4 lines can be easily done using bash single liner. Not bash single liner, shell single liner. So this we will see here. So for each in, so instead of dollar, you can use this also, ls-1 *.txt do echo $each done. Same effect. Okay. The thing is, it's very convenient to do it on the terminal itself rather than writing a script and doing it. Now I want to tar each 1.txt. So help me with this. Tar each is what? 1.txt, 2.txt, etc., etc. So before that, let me show you the syntax for tar. So tar is cf, c means create, f means file, 1.txt .tzz. Tzz means compressed, with gz compression. Okay. So I want to retain the extension 1.txt. And after that, I want to add .tzz, okay? So this is the syntax for tar. Done. I have to use z for this compression, which I haven't used. So now it is compressed. How do we know 1.txt dot it shows gzip compressed data from Unix, etc., etc., okay? So now I want to repeat this for all 1000 files. So let's get back to our for loop. So now we will replace this echo with our tar command, *cf. So this will be common for all, you agree? Yeah. So $each will be, suppose 1.txt or something. This append with .txt, let me see whether it works or not. And here $each. CZF. So ls *.tzz word count. So we have created 1000 compressed files. Similarly, you can create for zip. Although I personally don't recommend you to use zip, but in Linux we have a command for zip. So zip hyphen r. So same effect, dollar, instead of tgz we will use zip. Done. Ls *.zip. We have all the zip files. So this way it is very convenient. That's what I want to say. Using shell, using pipe, you can do repetitive tasks very easily. So we have seen tar and zip. So there is a command export which I used once, but I haven't explained. So export is to change your shell variable. Okay. So for example, echo. I forgot to explain what is echo. Echo is like printf. So if I say echo Srikanth, it will echo Srikanth. If I say echo ls, it will echo ls, like that. Okay. So echo you can use with inbuilt variables. So there is a variable path. These are shell inbuilt variables, shell environments. So this is my shell environment for path. So path actually gives you the path for the binary. Okay. So ls, sorry, which ls? So this tells me where is the ls binary. So ls binary is /bin/ls. And how do shell knows that where to look for ls? Because in my shell environment, if you see my shell environment, this one echo dollar path, there is somewhere bin/bin will be there. Okay, so somewhere here. So we know how to find out grep/bin. So it will highlight, and we know this one, right? So because it /bin is included in my dollar path variable, I can access ls command easily. For example, we have created this script.sh. Can I run script.sh directly? No, means it cannot auto complete if I do like this. It says command not found. The reason is the script.sh is not included in my path. So the shell doesn't know where to look for script.sh. So what I will do, I will export my path variable, dollar path, export my path variable, and I will append it to my existing path variable with /home/Srikanth. I'm just expanding the path which is known to you, set. What it does, it is exporting the environment variable path, it is adding /home/Srikanth/intern/set directory to my already existing dollar path variable. Dollar is a variable. In Linux shell scripting, dollar is a variable. And I hit enter. Okay, so let me try. Something went wrong. Any clue? So it hasn't added this directory into the path. So let me check my bash RC, which contains. Okay, so it should be path equals to. So what I have done here is path colon. Sorry. Okay. So now my new path variable is echo dollar path contains my newly added path. So this way, suppose you are working on a project which is, suppose you are working on a system where you don't have permission to add your binaries to your system file, system directory. See, what I can do is I can copy the script dot to my user bin, and I know user bin is already included in my system path. So whenever if I copy this, it will already in my path, so it will execute. But I don't have the permission because I'm a normal user. Only administrator has the permission. So in that case, what you will do, you will just do this for your particular directory so that it can be included in your .rel path. Once it's done, you can simply type script.sh. No need of .slash, bash, etc. Okay? I think that's it. Okay, thanks for joining. So if you have any questions, you have my email ID.